I'm Turi King, and I'm here with Sarah, who took part in Series 3 of DNA Family Secrets. Sarah was an Olympic athlete who came to us to find out the identity of her biological father. So, Sarah, for those who haven't seen the episode of DNA Family Secrets that you're in, talk me through the background to your question when you came to us. Why did you come?
Because I wanted to know where I got my athletic ability from. Is it just from my mom or was it from my dad?
So what did you know? So you came to us and you didn't know who your biological father was.
I knew a name, which I thought was his name, and I had a picture and that's it. And just little bits of what my mum had told me.
Yeah.
Just told me that his name was Tico Phillip. He was based here at the US Air Force in Suffolk. And I think she met him on a night out. Yeah. And that went on from there.
So you're born. Did he know about you?
So by the time she knew she was pregnant, he'd already gone back to America. He'd left here. So then when I was born, after 6 months, I think she sent him a letter. But I think his wife at the time intercepted the letter, which we never knew. And he managed to get the picture out of the card before his wife destroyed the letter. But on the back, it only said my first name and my middle name, not my surname.
So he had no way of knowing you, I suppose, as you're growing.
Yeah.
Did your mom ever try again?
Or? Yeah, so she said that she'd contacted the colonel of the airbase. He'd given her my dad's number. So she called the phone. His wife at the time picked up the phone and then kind of just hung up the phone. But then my mom was saying, like, it was easier for her to track him down. So if he really wanted to, he could have done the same thing. I think in his mind, he didn't believe that I was his. And he thought that's what the case was.
So I suppose you grow up and you have an amazing career. So talk me through that.
Yeah. So from when I was 7 or 8, I'd always like win school sports days. And my mom was saying I was be running around the garden when I was 2 or 3 years old. And then a coach from one of the clubs in Colchester came to my mom and said, like, your daughter's really good at track and field athletics. Bring her to the club one evening and just see if she likes it. And then when I was 16, I had my first major competition. I was covering for Denise Lewis because she was injured. So that's my first like major competition. And then from there, I went to Olympic Games, World Championships, indoors, outdoors, European Championships, indoors, outdoors, Commonwealth Games in Manchester.
Wow. So did your mom tell you terribly much about your dad? Was he like particularly athletic or anything? I suppose he wasn't very old, was he?
So I found out he was 26, so he's a few years older than my mum. They met each other, and then she said that he would come down on the weekends. She would cook for him and just talk and stuff like that. But I know my mum like did javelin and cross country when she was at school. And we was like walking back from school, we was trying to race each other, but I'd always win.
But this was something that we chatted about during DNA Family Secrets is that, you know, athletic ability, there's all kinds of different factors involved. Some of it will be genetic and body shape and all sorts of things, but also mental strength in terms of doing that. So this was the thing when you came, how were you doing? Because I thought, this is this amazing woman. You clearly have a lot of mental strength and that you've been able to pursue this career. Mm-hmm. Is that something that would be able to kind of help you through the next sort of stage in terms of looking for your dad? Were you nervous?
So nervous. And in my mind, it'd be like, they're not going to find him. They're going to find him. Not going to find him. They're going to find him. It's like a big roller coaster. I was in Dubai at the time. So my family was in the UK, but for the most part, just by myself, just going through all these emotions. Like, yeah, it was so nerve-wracking.
And how was your mom with it all?
She was more nervous than me. Because I think she didn't want me to feel disappointed in case he didn't want to know me or if he was had died or anything. And then obviously she's reliving her memories of how everything was as well. Yeah, she's definitely worse than what I was.
Because you didn't have tons to go on. So you had this name, Tico Phillips, which of course the first thing you do is you Google Tico Phillips. Nothing.
Nothing.
Out there.
Yeah, yeah.
You presumably tried all this
already. Yeah, for years. Yeah. I've got, like, 1 year, I'd be like, yeah, let me try and find him. So I'd go on Google, like Google everything. And I'd be like, you know, I'll leave it. Then 5 years later, I'd be like, let me try and find him again. Yeah. So it's always like that. But then obviously, because I didn't have his proper name, I couldn't find anything.
So when we start the process, we have absolutely no idea where it's going to go. Mm-hmm. And I remember thinking, wow, Tico Phillips, super quick check, can't find anything. Mm-hmm. But with DNA testing these days, I mean, you knew your dad was an American soldier.
Yes, yeah.
And DNA testing is hugely popular in the US. So I thought, okay, there's likely to be a good chance that we might be able to find some DNA matches. So what I do is I take your DNA and I'm starting to look like, who are you getting DNA matches with? And I'm trying to build a family tree to see if I can start to work out where your dad is. So I remember at this point, I could get you back to a family that was living in Virginia, a huge family that was living in Virginia in the latter part of the 19th century. I could then start to kind of build the family tree down and I could see this rather glamorous, beautiful woman who had had a son. And then a few years later, she marries and has kids. So from that, I could see that this first son, there wasn't a Tico in his name, but there was a Toledo as a middle name.
Yeah.
And I thought, okay, this makes sense. Need to get in contact with him. And he knew about you.
Yes.
So I remember you and I were both getting a bit teary because it's really big. How were you doing when I was able to kind of go, look, we found...
It's just all the emotions just came out. Because obviously up until that point, I just kept everything in. I wasn't really talking to anyone because I didn't want to be like... telling people and then all of a sudden like nothing happens. So I'm just keeping it to myself, but I guess that's like the wrong thing to do. And like my heartbeat's racing. I'm just like, I feel like lightheaded as well.
Yeah.
Like I'm going to pass out. And then you say like you found him. It's like, oh my God. It's like I'd left my body almost. That's what it felt like. Like I'd hear you talking, like see your mouth moving. Like even doing the Olympics, it's completely different. So when you say like you'd be able to mentally get, it's night and day.
I was going to ask that.
Yeah, yeah, it's completely different.
Does it like prepare you in any way, shape or form? Or does it completely go out of the window because this is so emotional?
Yes, this is more personal.
Yeah.
Whereas the Olympics, you're doing something to win a prize almost.
Yes.
So you're still uncertain if you're going to get it or not, but you kind of know I've done this training.
Yeah.
I'm at this point. Yeah. And if I do this, 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 then I can make the final or make the semifinal. With the DNA stuff, things like that, it's different.
You're not in control.
Yeah, exactly.
I suppose if you're doing your athletics, you're like really kind of mentally strong going,
yes,
I am in control. I know what my body can do.
Exactly.
Where if you're in this, I suppose it's kind of out of your control. Yeah. You don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah, yeah. I wasn't sleeping. And if I did sleep, I'd like sleep for like 2 hours. I'd be like fully awake, just thinking all the time.
It's a lot. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, I do the kind of the DNA bit. And we kind of let that sit, don't we, for a bit? Mm-hmm. And then you go and see Stacey, who then hits you with all of this stuff. So tell me what it's like. You go in and see Stacey.
So we sit in the chair first, outside. I'm shaking. Like I'm just, my whole body shaking. I'm like super emotional. Like you've just given me my dream. Like you've just told me, like my dad is there and he wants to know me. And then I go in with Stacey, we sit down. As I walk in, I can see like she had a little envelope at the side of her chair. I'm like, oh no, she doesn't want to sit, like, meet me or something. And like, obviously I sit down and then she says, oh yeah, we found him. Then she reaches down and gets the envelope. Yeah, at that point, again, I'm just like underwater. Like, it's weird.
Stacey had a letter.
Yeah, it's strange. Just seeing his emotions on the card. Just knowing that he had been thinking about me. Like he had been trying to find me. Yeah, it was nice. I still have it. I'm going to frame it at some point. But yeah, it was really nice just to get something concrete that is actually there. I know you get the pictures, but having a card with his writing and his thoughts on the card is, it was nice.
Yeah. Because you were worried, like, what if we find him, but he doesn't want to.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Because you see it all the time, like people try to find their families and they're like, we don't want to know. That ship sailed or, so in the back of your mind, you always have that in there as well.
I mean, and that is something we always try to prepare people for because we don't know what we're going to find at the other side of things. And it does happen where we find somebody and they aren't in the right place or something in their lives to be able to deal with it, or they've kind of put it in the past and they don't want to deal with it anymore.
Yeah.
But it must have been nice then that your dad does want that.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Contact. Yeah, yeah. It was a nice surprise. He's told me like recently he had been trying to find me. He said he'd watched like TV shows or he'd watched sporting events to try and see if he recognized anyone with the same features as him and stuff like that.
So, but did he know? Did he know that you were an athlete?
And he watched the Beijing Olympics. He said he watched the opening ceremony because he was trying to see. But obviously I wasn't there. I was still in Macau at that point. So he said, he was trying to see if he could recognize anybody, but he had no clue. So he, I was into athletics.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Didn't know anything.
That's amazing. Mm-hmm. So he's watching these things, wondering whether or not he's going to see you, but without knowing you're an athlete.
Exactly. So I'm pretty sure he probably watched the final of the hurdles. But in America, they showed just their athletes. So I'm thinking he must have watched the final because the USA had three athletes in that race. So he must have seen and not put it together that that's me.
How amazing is that? That's so cool.
It's crazy.
And how was your mom with it all?
She was shocked. Because in her mind as well, she thought that either he had passed away already or he just probably wouldn't be interesting after all this time of not trying to find me himself.
Yeah.
It's just surreal.
And this is the other question I always have because I catch up with people afterwards to find out how it's going because we don't know how it's going to go. Mm-hmm. So for some people, it's really difficult. And it must be difficult for you to some extent because your dad is in another country and others, like, they meet and kind of nothing ever really develops. Mm. Or others, they're close enough by that they can develop a bond that happens and it's lovely. People get enveloped completely into the family. Mm-hmm. What's it been like for you guys to...
It's been different to say, like, I have a dad now. And I'm talking to him like almost every day. But it's hard because in my mind, I thought, yeah, I'd love him straight away. And we'd be like, he's my dad. And I'd call him dad like all the time. But I don't. It's weird. Like when I'm messaging, I'll just say hi or good morning. And he'll be like, hi, daughter, and stuff like this. It still feels foreign to say my dad or to have like the feelings there. Like, oh, I love my dad. It's not there yet. Which I feel bad about because I'm not too sure how it should be. Like, should I love him straight away or does it take time? Well, like, everyone's different.
But that makes sense because you haven't grown up with him around. You haven't got that history with somebody. Mm-hmm. All the little tiny things that create bonds as you are growing up with somebody or you know somebody over a long period of time. So presumably it will take time to build that. Yeah. Relationship and made all the harder because he's in the US.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, so far away. Yeah. Like, it's hard just talking on the phone.
Yeah.
It's not the same.
Definitely. But you've been over?
Yeah, yeah. So after I found out on Easter Sunday, I was at a friend's house because she was having like a party and I see a number come on my phone. It said Florida. Like, oh my God, it's my dad. So he said that he timed it for Easter, like new beginnings and Easter holidays and stuff to get in contact with me because I thought he was going to email me back. We actually called, so that's the first time I spoke to him on the phone.
Yeah.
So from April up until August, we were talking like nearly every day. So I think it made it easier for when I actually did meet him in person. It wasn't so awkward because we'd been talking already. So in the first week of August, I flew to Florida from Dubai.
He must be so proud of you.
Yeah, he says he is, yeah. Every 5 years, we get a card in the post that says, once an Olympian, always an Olympian. So I sent him a picture of the car and he goes, oh, I'm so proud of you, of like what you've done and stuff like that. And he can actually see it, like it's there on Google or on Wikipedia. It's not just me telling him, it's like physically it's there. You can see videos of me running and stuff like that. So yeah, he's definitely happy.
So there's a little parallel between your story and your dad's story, because I could see in the records that he had been born before his mom, so your grandma, had gotten married.
Yes.
And it turned out he didn't know who his dad was either. And I could see that you were getting DNA matches into this particular family. Mm-hmm. So after knowing your dad didn't know who his dad was, I started building a little bit more around that. And we've managed to find his dad for him too.
Yeah, that was crazy.
How's that been for him? Was
that
it
was
okay?
Crazy. So when you were telling me, it's like you were messaging me, I'm messaging my dad. I'm like, you need to sit down. What's wrong? And I'm like, Chewie's found your dad. He's like, what? Like, yeah, she's found your dad and your brother, like half brother, and your granddad. Like you said, the parallels of like our journey, visiting almost the same places and just not knowing who our dads were. From finding me, he's managed now, he's found his other family as well.
Yeah.
So I think it just took him a while just to process everything and to see that, again, the parallels on his dad's side as well, like the Navy, the Air Force, like military family for sure.
So you've done all of this now.
Mm-hmm.
Are you happy?
Oh yeah, definitely. Very happy. Because now I can say, like, my dad is this person, his name is this, he lives here, he's this age, and yeah, it's been definitely a dream come true.
Sarah, thanks so much for catching up with me.